All the construction professionals who have logged in today, and today our speaker Dr. K. Gunasekaran would be talking about a very interesting topic which affects all of us, in fact, the construction industry and the public in general. So he is going to talk about special concrete and its application for sustainability. Sustainability, of course, is the buzzword nowadays, because as all of us know, that we need to fulfill our requirements, and at the same time we should ensure that the future generations are also having the natural resources. So that's a very good topic, and we as civil engineers as well as professionals have a lot of responsibility on us as far as sustainability in concrete is concerned. On the speaker of the day, he's a professor at SRM Institute of Science and Technology at Kattankulathur, Dr. K. Gunasekaran. He got awarded PhD in the year 2011 for the works done on utilization of coconut shell as coarse aggregate in the development of lightweight concrete in SRM University. In fact, that is very interesting, because normally we are all attuned to the normal concrete, which is having a density of 2400 kg per cubic meter. But the thing is that, can we reduce the dead weight of concrete? Normally what happens is that most of them only talk about cement and its chemistry, but what about aggregates? And here is the topic for today, where he has done a lot of work in the area of concrete and usage of coconut shell in the development of lightweight concrete. Presently, he is having 28 years of experience, academic 21 years and industry 7 years. A major area of interest is concrete technology. He developed one of the special lightweight concrete using coconut shell as aggregate. Published 14 international papers in SCI indexed journals, 39 Corpus Index journal papers, 3 national journal papers, and 14 papers in international conferences, 10 papers in national level conferences, written 1 technical note, and 3 books with ISBN numbers, and published 4 patents. Developed a coconut shell crusher for crushing the coconut shell as aggregate to use in concrete production. Guided 2 PhD and guiding 7 PhD research scholars. Guided 40 postgraduate projects and 26 undergraduate and 20 programs in the field of civil engineering. And he has coordinated and conducted 3 international conferences, 1 national level conferences, 12 programs. Reviewer for some of the reviewed and referred journals like Construction and Building Materials, Materials and Structures, European Journal of Environment and Civil Engineering. So that's the speaker of the day today. Before handing over to the speaker, let me also talk a few initiatives that Ramco Cements has been taking in the recent past. As we were emphasizing in the earlier discussion, that we have been customizing cement based on the concrete requirements. And you would find that Ramco Cement manufactures all types of cement which is being normally used. Ordinary Portland cement, rapid hardening Portland cement, Portland Pozzolana cement, Portland slag cement, sulfate resistant Portland cement. So the idea of having this 12 brands of cement is that, based on the concrete requirements, you know, we go to the site, we prepare a questionnaire based on how much slump is required, how much concrete strength is required, what is the chemical admixture that is being used at site. After taking all those details, the type of cement is recommended. As you can see here, Ramco Infra 53 grade, Infra 43 grade are cements which is meant for longer slump retention. And rapid hardening Portland cement is for all precast items. Even within Portland cement, we have supergrade, supercrete, superfine, superplus. Supercrete is a cement which is having a high rate of strength as well as low heat of hydration. And that has been developed as far as the requirement of construction professionals is concerned, because they wanted a cement which is having high strength and at the same time have a low heat of hydration. So that is the specialty of Ramco Supercrete. Portland slag cement is, of course, we are manufacturing. So what you can see is that we do not recommend only one type of cement. We have so many types of cement which is recommended based on the concrete requirement. So that is something that needs to look at, you know. So these are the cements that we have got. Apart from it, we have got dry mix products. Dry mix products are only meant for non-structural application. It must not be used for any structural application. Like, say, for example, you have Ramco Tile Fix, Ramco Super Plaster, Ramco Block Fix, Ramco Self-Curing Plaster, Super Bond, Super Fine, and Tile Grout. So you will find that there are so many products for non-structural applications. Now, all this customization has taken place because of a lot of research and development that is taking place in our Ramco Research and Development Center. It is not only a purely research center, but also we take feedback from the construction professionals at sites, and based on that we make the concrete mix designs, as well as it is having lot of facilities for testing of raw material, testing of cement. So based on this, what happens is, you know, we have a data bank of various concrete mixes with different chemical admixtures which is available in the market, so that you know, before any project professional goes in for concreting work, he will be able to understand how Ramco cement behaves with various chemical admixtures. So some of the facilities, I am not going to the detail of this, but just an overview of what kind of facilities we have at the Ramco Research and Development Center. We have some of these equipments that are there to analyze the particle size distribution of powder materials, thermogravimetric analysis to study the thermal behavior of cement raw materials and concrete, PET surface area analysis for studying the surface area and micropores of fine materials like fly ash, fly husk ash, etc. So these are some of the things that we have got. And then we have the automatic compressive testing machine, of course, which is used for testing the compressive strength of concrete, rapid chloride ion penetration testing apparatus for testing the durability of concrete. In fact, this is as per ASTM standard, where you can test the durability of concrete. In fact, durability is one of the critical parameters as far as sustainability is concerned, because if you're able to give longer life to concrete structures, then the sustainability is taken care of. And we also have optical microscope as well as stereo microscope for studying the orientation stereoscopic view of minerals. We have the X-ray diffractometer, mercury intrusion porosimeter to study the pore size distribution. And apart from the rapid chloride penetration test, we also have the DIN standard water permeability test, which is being used for testing the durability of concrete by looking at the water penetration through concrete cubes, or even cylinders can be used as specimen. So this test is also used for checking the durability of concrete. We have been given the Four Leaves Award for leadership in technology, leadership in the usage of blending materials, and utilization of various other materials in the cement itself, so that which gives qualitative advantage. Few of our customers with whom we have good collaboration, because after all, if we have a good collaboration with customers, we would be able to understand the ground realities. Like say, for example, Larsen & Toubro, we have been associated with them. They have various kinds of projects in different segments, whether it be buildings and factories, bridges, flyovers, underground works. So you can see that the concrete mix that is required for various kinds of applications are different. Exposure conditions are different. Similar is the case with other customers also. ITD Cementation, we have been catering to their cement requirements in most of their sites. We have approval from various metro projects also, Bangalore Metro, Chennai Metro, Cochin Metro, and Delhi Metro. And some of the projects in eastern part of the country, Haldia Development Authority, Delhi Buildcon Limited, Gammon India, and all that, we have got good this thing. Again, as part of our this thing, we have been conducting various webinars since the lockdown, and we have had a series of webinars on various topics ranging from blended cements to concrete to smart cities to ready mix concrete. Then we had a session on contract management, reinforcement detailing. So you'll find that even sustainability, there was a panel discussion. And we would be having one more webinar today, because this series of webinars will be continuing. Tomorrow we have a webinar by Mr. Rashid Merchant, Vice President Quality Control of PRISM RMC, who would be talking about busting certain concrete myths from a practical perspective. So that's it as far as our initiatives are concerned. Now let me again welcome the speaker of the day, Dr. Gunashekaran, who would be talking to us about an important aspect of the sustainability. And sir, you can go in for sharing the content, sir, your presentation.
Yes, sir. Before I share,
yeah,
I'll give some brief information about the presentation today. Shall I proceed, sir?
Yes, sir. Please, sir. You can, sir.
My voice is clear now?
Yeah, your voice is clear.
Okay, sir. Anaivarukkum vanakkam. Namaskar. Very good morning to all of you. So before I share the presentation PPT, let me give some overview of the today's presentation. See, I'm going to give about some special concrete and its application for sustainability. So in this, I'm going to cover what is meant by comrade and what is meant by special comrade. What is comrade and what is special comrade? In what are the different types of comrades and special comrades are there? In that, I have collected only four, like lightweight comrade, fiber reinforced comrade, and self-comporting comrade, and also reactive powder comrade. If time permits, I will be touching on some other types of comrade also. So this is how I am going to cover, and now I am going to share the PPT.
We are able to see that. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Right, yeah,
sir.
We are able to see.
First of all, I thank you, Sri Anil Kumar Pillai, sir, for giving me that warm welcome and introduction to the participant about me. And also, I thank Sri Suraj Kumar, the host of this webinar, for his coordination with me for getting trial under. And also, I thank Mr. Surya Kumar from Ramco for inviting me and then asking me about this webinar. And then it's my pleasure. He is also alumni of SRM. Now I join for the presentation now. So I'm going to talk about special concrete and its application for sustainability. So let me ask the question, which is the most widely used substance on the earth? Normally I used to ask the question and then getting the answer from the participant, then we will discuss. But now it is a one-way traffic, like a only presentation, discussion towards the end only. So I'll give the answer itself. So next to which is the most widely used substance on the earth means it's simply water. Of course, air is that. Whether we are living in America or Australia, every human being and everybody is required air. Every moment we need the air. So leaving that one, next to air is water. Whether you are living again east or west or north or south, every human being is required water for living purpose. Of course, we may live without water for maximum of 7 days, from the scientific point of view. But beyond that, it's not possible, irrespective of the habitation of the human being. So water is the most substance which is used widely in the earth. So what is the next material? What is the next material after the water which is used in the human, that is on the earth? No doubt on that, it is concrete. So what is concrete? It's nothing but a mixture of cement, fine aggregate, coarse aggregate, and water. Now, to understand that what is concrete, so let me take an example of a normal South Indian favorite daily used item, idli and dosa. Most of you today also had idli and dosa. There should be some proportion for idli and dosa flour or batter. So the ingredients used for this is nothing but rice, Ural dal, fenugreek, salt, and water. So if you properly do some proportions among these ingredients, you will get a proper idli or dosa. Sometimes the idli and dosa may not be on the expected level. By the time if you ask our mother or wife, they used to say, sir, I think we missed something in the proportion between rice and dal. That's why it's happened today. Please adjust like that, they'll use us. Next day, we'll take care of the lecture. Likewise, concrete is also having some basic ingredients like cement, sand, coarse aggregate, and water. If you do some proportioning, we'll get the concrete. But if you do not proportion it, what is your expectation from the concrete in terms of workability or in terms of strength, then it will not give proper concrete. Making use of the same ingredients of cement, sand, aggregate, and water, it is possible to go for producing good concrete as well as bad concrete. Both the things are in our hand only. So if you properly maintain, if you properly go for the proportion suggested by the designer, then you'll get the good concrete with the proper expectation from the workability point of view and strength point of view. Then, the concrete is the only compatible material construction point of view. This is the only construction material which having the most compatible compared to all other construction material, because All the ingredients are available readily, cheaply in everywhere. Only artificial material is cement. Other than cement, fine aggregate, reverse alkali, coarse aggregate, everywhere it is available. Water available. Only thing is cement. Nowadays also, even in the remote villages also, cement is readily available. So all the ingredients are readily available in cheapest manner. If you decide now, within half an hour you can collect it, you can mix it. Doesn't matter what type of concrete, whether it's a good concrete or bad concrete. Concrete is a concrete one. So that is possible only in case of concrete. No other material will give this easy approach. The second one is the energy required to produce the concrete is very less. It doesn't require any much effort. Just collect the material, just add some proportion, mix it, and then get it. But if you decide now, you cannot able to produce 1 gram of steel or 1 gram of aluminium, 1 gram of gold. Lot of effort is required. Energy is required. So the energy required to produce the concrete is also very less. And then you can imagine whatever may the pattern you wanted to have for your architectural point of view or aesthetic point of view, it is possible making use of concrete. Only thing is we have to frame your formwork or mold. So no other material will give this kind of flexibility, like a regular section, irregular section, like that. So just close your eye, you get some pattern. After that, if you want to get the pattern, just create a mold or formwork and then prepare the concrete, fill it in that mold. After setting, just remove it, you'll get the pattern. That flexibility is there in case of concrete. Similarly, basic ingredients are cement, aggregate, and water. But if you feel any other material as a waste, you can put it in the concrete. That is why the Sasol concretes are developed. But no other material will accommodate any waste in this unit. For example, steel is having one limitation. Copper is having one limitation. Aluminium is having one limitation. But concrete doesn't have that kind of limitation. Whatever material you are feeling as a waste, you can try with the concrete. Only thing is, we have to do the research on that for your requirement in terms of workability, in terms of strength, in terms of durability, in terms of structural element. Only thing is, if you do proper research on that, if it is satisfied, then it can be implemented for the society. So that fluctuation, that flexibility is there in case of concrete. No other metal will give you this kind of concrete. That is a flexibility. Now, what is special concrete? Nowadays, lot of technologies are developed, improved in all the areas, especially in concrete. For example, earlier we know there were only two types of engineering. One is called military engineering, other one is called civil engineering. Any work which is taking care of defense purpose, then it is called military engineering. Other than that, it's called civil engineering. But nowadays, you see, n number of specializations of engineering are there. So likewise, earlier there was a concrete, mint concrete. It's a mixture of cement, fine aggregate, coarse aggregate, and water. But now the definition for concrete is redefined because of the development of technology and the invention of some admixtures and additives. Now the definition for concrete is redefined as it's a mixture of cement, fine aggregate, coarse aggregate, water, without and with admixtures. That is the redefinition nowadays. So what is special concrete now? So normal concrete will have its normal characteristics and properties. If you change anything, any material, maybe a cement replacement, maybe a fine aggregate replacement, maybe a coarse aggregate, or even for water, if you change any proportion or any material, replace, alternate, then the properties of the concrete will get changed. For example, if you want to use the normal concrete under the water, it is not possible. Because the normal concrete will have the initial setting time of minimum of 30 minutes. After 30 minutes only, it will start to set. In that condition, if you put the concrete under the water, cement will go on its own way, fine aggregate pressure will go on its own way. So you will not get the proper yielding of concrete under the water by that time when you use normal concrete. So in that case, you are in that situation, you have to go for replacing the cement with the rapid hardening cement or quick setting cement. Of course, there are some wastage in that case also, but that cannot be avoided. So likewise, when you have a element, a structural element, when you are having very high element, which is to be taken very high load, because of that there is a congested area of reinforcement you have provided. In that case, if you pour the normal concrete, the compaction will not be proper. Even if you go for any vibration techniques, there may be a chance of getting unequal in the concrete where the congested reinforcements are there. So to avoid that kind of honeycomb formation in that particular area, we may go for the self-compacting concrete. That is, on its own, it will get compacted without any use of external vibrator. So likewise, many situations are there where we need to go for the special type of concrete in special situations. To understand easily what is concrete and special concrete, again, I'll take an example, the normal idli and dosa. So every day we used to have idli and dosa in a normal manner, but when you have some special occasion day or along with some of your friends or some celebration of some parties and other way in a weekend or monthly ones, when you go for the restaurants, normally we will not order the normal idli and normal dosa. We'll go for some special dosa. See that this is normal idli and normal dosa, and see that this is one of the display about variety of dosa available in the particular restaurant. Likewise, in all the restaurants nowadays, there are 99 variety of dosas are available. But when you see the basic ingredients of this variety of dosa, it's normally only rice, ural dal, fenugreek seed, and water. And in that normal ingredients, if they had something new or something extra, then they give the some special name for that. If you had the some rava, then it is called rava dosa. Along with the dosa, if you say put some masala, then it is called masala dosa. In variety of masala dosa also, paneer masala, but mushroom masala like that. So variety of dosas are there, but all the dosas are having the basic ingredients of same one. So likewise, in case of special concrete, some speciality is there in the concrete, but the basic ingredients are okay. Remind same cement, fine aggregate, porosity, and sand one. So if you do something extra, then we'll get some special properties. So in the way, if you remember, so it is easy to categorize what is special concrete and what is normal concrete. So as I said earlier, any concrete which meets special performance and that cannot be always achieved routinely by using only conventional material and normal mixing, placing, and curing practices, that is called special concrete. So concrete produced with some special characteristics falls under special concrete. Now it is a need of the hour, sustainability. What is sustainable concrete? So a concrete which meets the performance required by either the owner or the designer or the contractor or the producer of the concrete is called a sustainable concrete. So the purpose of the owner side or purpose of the designer side, if it, your concrete is meeting the requirement of those designer or owner or the architecture or the producer or the contractor, it is simply called a sustainable concrete. So in addition, if you are able to minimize the energy for the environmental degradation or the saving that the environmental global warming is due to emission of carbon dioxide. So if you are able to reduce the emission of carbon dioxide because of your effort or the usage of potable water, if you are able to reduce it, if at all the third war is coming, means it is for the water purpose only. People are saying that maybe third world war means it is because of water. So we have to save the water also. So in that case, if you are able to reduce the use of water in the concrete production, or if you are able to use the waste in the concrete to increase the use of recycled content, can also be called as a sustainable concrete. So this is the need of the hour for everyone. So whoever may be, wherever, whatever may be the specialization, they have to look into the sustainability nowadays. So as I said, many types of special concretes are there. So how to produce the special concrete? You have to either replace it or partially replace it or completely replace it or addition like additive or admixtures. Then you will be getting the some special type of concrete. In that, I have listed only a few special type of concrete: lightweight concrete, self-compacting concrete, fiber reinforced concrete, reactive powder concrete, of course, different weather concrete, hot weather, cold weather, and spot concrete. So the lead highlighted in red color, I will concentrate today's presentation. If time permits, we'll go for the other type of concrete also. Now first, let me take what lightweight concrete. So before I proceed with the sustainable point of view, let me give some overview about what is lightweight concrete. So lightweight concrete may be defined as the concrete of sustainability, sorry, substantially lower unit weight than that made from gravel or crushed stone. So if you are replacing that gravel or crushed stone and you are able to produce the concrete with a unit weight is lesser than the non-conventional concrete, then it can be called as a lightweight concrete. One of the disadvantages of conventional concrete is the high self weight of concrete. Ordinary concrete is quite heavy and its density is in the order of 2200 kg per meter cube to 2600 kg per meter cube. So this heavy self weight will make it to some extent an uneconomical structural material. Ordinary concrete is not suitable for use, especially in floor or roof filling as filler in general. So if you use this, it adds considerably to the dead weight of the structures. So by using suitable aggregate, the density of concrete can be reduced. The lightweight concrete not only result in reducing the dead weight on the structure, but also has a better insulation against heat and sound. That is the specialty of the lightweight concrete. The strength of such concrete is very low, but this concrete is not expected to bear any loads normally. Because of the light weight, this concrete is very suitable for earthquake proof structures. Now, what are the advantages of lightweight concrete? You can say many advantages. One is a reduction of dead load. It increases the progress of buildings, the structures. There is a less transport and handling cost. The weight of a building on the foundation is an important factor in design, particularly in case of a weak soil and tomb structures. In framed structures, the beams and columns have to carry load of floors and walls. If floors and walls are made up of lightweight concrete, it will result in considerable economy. Another most important characteristic of lightweight concrete is the relatively low thermal conductivity. In extreme climatic condition, and also in case of buildings where air conditioning is to be installed, the use of lightweight concrete with low thermal conductivity will be of considerable advantage from the point of thermal comforts and lower power consumption. The addition of lightweight concrete gives an outlet for industrial waste. You can use any other waste, which is if you are filling as a waste, like a clinkers, flyers, slag, etc. And also some of the agricultural waste, like my presentation based on coconut shell. Likewise, coconut shell, oil palm shell, palm kernel shell, which otherwise create some disposal problem. Now, what are the classifications of lightweight concrete are there? There are three classifications are there. One is called a structural lightweight concrete. It can be used for structural element like a beam, column, slab. And non-load bearing concrete, it can be maybe a partition wall or some non-structural element like a hollow block, solid block, power block like that. And specifically, you can use it for insulating concrete. So those are the three classifications of lightweight concrete. So how to make this lightweight concrete basically? So there are three ways are there normally if you go for the literature. By replacing the usual conventional aggregate by cellular porous or lightweight aggregate, that is one of the methods. The second one is we can introduce the gas or air bubbles into the cement or concrete. That is known as aerated concrete. So in the way we can reduce the weight of the concrete. The third one is we can completely eliminate the fine aggregate part. That is called no fine concrete. So in the way also you can produce the lightweight concrete. So when you say lightweight aggregates, I'm concentrating on the use of lightweight aggregates in the concrete production to produce the lightweight concrete. When you say lightweight aggregates, it can be classified into two categories, namely natural lightweight aggregate and artificial lightweight aggregate. The natural lightweight aggregates are found from many places. And they were also not of uniform quality. So as such, they are not used very widely in making lightweight concrete. Out of the natural lightweight aggregate, pumice is the only one which is used in the lightweight concrete production. So like a pumice stone, the bulk density of the pumice stone is 500 to 800 kg per meter cube. And it will give a concrete having density 800 kg per meter cube to 1100 kg per meter cube. And it also has some high insulation, thermal insulation, and strength about 15 to 40 megapascal. Then another natural aggregates are there called diatomite, likewise scoria, then volcanic cinders, sawdust, rice husk ash, and then coconut shell, then oil palm shell, palm kernel shell. Likewise, many natural aggregates are there from both naturally as well as from agricultural waste point of view. Then when come to the artificial aggregate, it's also used in the case of production of lightweight concrete, like making use of brick bats, clinker, foam slab, then expanded vermiculite slate, bloated clay, sintered fly ash, expanded perlite, like that. So where we can apply this kind of lightweight concrete? So generally, can you go for the situation like where the deck slab or long span bridges are there? There you can go for this kind of lightweight concrete application. Then fire and corrosion protection, if you want, there also you can apply. Covering for your architectural purpose, there also you can use it. And then where you want to go for heat insulation on roof or insulation for water pipes or filling for your roof or floor slab, construction of partition walls, panel walls in your framed structures, and then a production of some precast block like a hollow block, solid block, fire block like that for low cost housing. So these are the situation you can go for the application of lightweight concrete. Then as I said, natural and artificial. This is the picture shows in a village, a remote village, where the metal quarries are there. See that the first figure shows the level of the ground. This is the first figure, that's a level of the earth ground. And see how this is getting depleted and how much depth they are gone for the extracting, exploiting the natural resources. These pictures is taken in a remote village. Like that, in that same village, so many pots are there. And the towns, again, you just accumulate, just calculate and imagine how much natural resources we are getting exploited. Likewise, for a district level, state level, country level, world level, you look at that, how we are destroying the natural resources. So we have to think about the severity of non-availability of natural resources. And we have the responsibility to save the nature and protect the environment. So the concept of reuse and recycling different waste have been used in the development of special concrete. So here, we are going to discuss some of the kind of waste which is used in this sustainability lightweight concrete production. Generally, waste are generated from industry, domestic, and agriculture. These are the different waste in general. They are tried in the concrete production. Many researchers are taking different wastes in general. Textile waste, ceramic waste, plastic waste, rubber waste, marble waste. So even the engine oil, crude oil, that also they are tried in the concrete. So that much of flexibility is there in case of concrete. So these are the only example I'm giving. Apart from this, many wastes are there. So these are the name of those waste. And coming to the agricultural waste, again, many wastes are there, like oil palm shell, palm kernel shell, sawdust, wood waste, groundnut shell, bamboo, fibers, coconut. Again, I am telling these are some simple example only. Again, list may go in length. So these are the name of some of the agricultural waste. Now, we are talking about lightweight concrete. When we can say the concrete, whatever may be the material you are replacing it, when your concrete can be said, or when your concrete can be said, it's a lightweight concrete. For that, there are some codes and standards we use normally referred. So for that, if the conventional concrete density is, we know it is approximately 2200 to 2600. Now the American Concrete Institute says that if a concrete is, that is the American Concrete Institute 318 code, says that if a concrete density is 1850, then it is called lightweight concrete. British standard BS3797 says that the concrete density does not exceeding 2000 kg per meter cube, then it can be classified as a lightweight concrete. Similarly, Australian standard AS3600 says that the range for lightweight concrete from 1800 to 2100. In China, there is a code book called JGJ51. It says that concrete density does not exceed 1950, then it is called lightweight concrete. But if you look at some standard textbook, like a concrete technology by A.M. Nevely or M.S. Shetty or Professor A.S. Santakumar, in that you can find that The range for lightweight concrete is 300 kg per meter cube to 1850 kg per meter cube. But the literature says nowadays, many papers are there, if the density of concrete is not exceeding 2200 kg per meter cube, then it can be called as a lightweight concrete. That means the minimum is 300 and the maximum is 2200. Beyond 2200, we cannot say it is a lightweight concrete. That is the conclusion from this different standard references. So, as I said earlier, the three ways are there: use of lightweight aggregate, use of air-ash, that is inclusion of air, aerated concrete, and then replacing the no fine concrete, no fine aggregate. So likewise here, the use of lightweight aggregate I have taken. So what are the aggregates can be called as a lightweight concrete? Again, like a lightweight concrete, there is a limitation for aggregate density. American concrete says that from 600 to 850. British standard says that 250 to 1000. Australian standard said that if the density of aggregate is less than 1200 kg per meter cube, that can be classified as a lightweight aggregate. So, to produce a sustainable lightweight concrete, I have taken that coconut shell as a coarse aggregate because it is one kind of agricultural waste. So, if you look at the production of coconut all over the world, more than 93 countries are producing this coconut. And the top 10 countries are given the next slide. Out of that, India is playing the third place after Indonesia and Philippines. These Indonesia, Philippines, and India accounts more than 80% of the total world productions. If we consider the India country-wise, more than the 90% of the production of the Indian coconut production is concentrated in the South India, especially in Kerala and Tamil Nadu. So, these are the top 10 countries. Indonesia, Philippines, and India accounts for the top, playing the top three and accounts for 80% of the total production. This is how the coconut shells are available in the coconut industry. So after the scrapping is discarded as a waste, see that a small video. It's one of the coconut shell industry where they are using this coconut shell for crushing the form of powder, coconut as powder, and they are using it in the production of mosquito coil and the agarbattis. So this is the factory they are using for crushing the coconut shell in the form of powder. See, they are using it in a mosquito coil and agarbattis for long-standing purpose. Nowadays, the advertisements are coming. This particular mosquito coil will stand for more than 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours. All that because of addition of this coconut husk. Because it is having a long-standing burning ability. That is the reason why they are using it in mosquito coil and agarbattis. Not only that, the coconut shell used in many ornamental works like house utensil. And these are some examples. This is a cup and saucer, handbag, that is a night lamp, mat, then ice cream cup, ornamentals, even for some small type of window. And of course, they are using for activated carbon, like water purifier. In the water purifier, they are using it here, activated carbon. And see that this shows that the coconut shell is a, though it is a wood-based material or timber-based material, it is 100% non-biodegradable. Like in the other beach site, normally we used to see that in the beach site, seashell made ornamental works, like a string and then chains like that. But when you go to the Kerala site, most of the seashore, they are showing this kind of ornamental works making use of coconut shell. They are doing it from long time back. So that shows that the durability doesn't matter for using coconut shell concrete. It's 100% non-biodegradable. So even then, chemical engineers are using in the chemical point of view, adding is in the mosquito coil and agarbattis, and other normal people are doing that, some using that in normal ornamental works. But still, large percentage of coconut shells are discovered daily. So what to do with that waste? So I have taken that coconut shell. Why don't you use the shell as a coarse aggregate in the production of concrete? So this idea came in my mind through my guide. Based on the literature effort on oil palm shell concrete. Oil palm shell production is more than 50% is produced in Malaysian country compared to overall world production. So they use that oil palm shell as a coarse aggregate in the concrete production, and they have come to the level of implementing the structural element. They constructed a pakka house and pakka building making use of oil palm shell concrete after studying all the properties. So why don't we try? Because India is taking a third place for the production of coconuts. And then we started slowly taking the coconut shell, and we are trying to use this coconut shell as aggregate in the concrete. But we used to say that in normal concrete, normal aggregate, flakiness of the aggregate is not advisable, and we are allowing only a few percentage, maybe a 30% maximum. But as far as this coconut shell is concerned, it is 100% flaky material. Even for any small size, it is 100% flaky material. But the idea is how to use this, having this flaky material in the concrete production, and how to do the research on that, and how to implement to the society point of view to make a sustainable one. That is the idea behind this, taking coconut shell as aggregate in the concrete production. So initially, of course, the stiffness of the coconut shell is very less compared to conventional aggregate. So when you go for 20 mm normal conventional aggregate size, definitely we may face some problem for strength point of view. So initial stage itself, we restricted the next size of normal conventional aggregate, what we are using it, 12.5. So that size we have restricted. And in the initial stage, we engage the labor after collecting the raw material from the market to press the coconut shell in the form of aggregate. Again, I quickly saw that how they are doing it. So this is how we engage the labor to crush the coconut shell. So likewise, we engage the labor and clean that coconut shell top and inside. They are done like this. And finally, they crush and through the 12.5 normal sieving. And we have used in the concrete production. But the question is, how long we can go for engaging labor for crushing the coconut shell to make aggregate? Because labor charge will become more than the cost of the concrete, non-conventional concrete per meter cube. So in the initial stage research point of view, it's okay because I need to get some purpose of solving from my side research, and I need to develop the concrete. In that case, I may spend money. But how the people will accept for that? So the question is, how long we can engage the labor for crushing the material? For that purpose, we were tried to develop a crusher, especially for crushing the coconut shell into the form of aggregate. For that purpose, we were tried with the conventional crusher, which are available for crushing different material. The first figure shows that the normal crusher, which is boulders are crushing to get the conventional crusher aggregate. The second one is a ordinary flour mill. There also we tried. The third one is a groundnut shell crusher. There also we have tried. And from this, we got the concept that the groundnut shell crusher concept may work out for developing a crusher for crushing the coconut shell. And we have done a lot of trials. And finally, we have developed a crusher in SRM for crushing the coconut shell into the required size and shape. And we got the patent also on this. We applied that. Now it is the published stage. I just saw this quickly, how the pressure is getting working. See, there is a main body in this crusher. This is the input. This is the input where you can place the coconut shell raw material. This is the main body where the concept of impact arrangement is there. Then it can crush within a fraction of a second. So in the mission itself, we have made an arrangement, whatever size you wanted to have, that arrangement we have already made it. So if you want get 12.5 maximum, we'll get it. If you want go for 20 mm, that is also possible. But the crushing time is very, very, very fraction of second. If you do the raw material at the input at the top, in the main body, there is an impact arrangement. So due to this impact, the coconut will get crushed like this, and it will come to the sieve. We can sieve it and segregate it, and it can be stored like this. And see that there are two surfaces for coconut shell. One is smooth surface, other one is hard surface, because it has some natural, and it will give us some advantage while doing the coconut production. Now, I'm not going to details about the what are the tests in your different systematic procedure you have to do it, and but what are the tests to be done? That only I'm going to discuss, because already the time is now nearly 45 minutes, 11:45. Whenever you are going for a new material, first you have to study about the properties of that material, physical properties, chemical properties, mechanical properties. See that, is it feasible to apply then, use it in concrete? Even then, if it is not fit for that, we have to do some treatment, and then after treatment, we can be used for the production of concrete. Then, after studying the physical, mechanical, so chemical properties, you have to do with the style mixes. Whenever you are going for the replacement of any material or alternate for any material in the concrete production, there is no other way, only trial and error. Whatever may be the mix design procedures are there, it is only applicable for making use of conventional concrete. So for your material, there is no, for new material, there is no standard procedure. We have to develop after establishment of a concrete, what is our mix design procedure. That is different story. So using some trial mixes, you target with minimum probability and then a minimum strength. Try to achieve that by doing some trial mixes. And then if you are meeting that requirement of workability and strength point of view, then you study about mechanical properties like your flexural strength, split tensile, impact, modulus of plasticity, like that. And then necessary, if it is necessary, do pull-out test for bonding properties. Then definitely you must go for durability properties like your water absorption, sorptivity, permeable pore voids, RCPT, salt bonding, like chloride penetration, many things are there. So whatever feasible is possible, and then you got to do the durability point of view. Then if need, thermal properties, depending upon your material properties. And then after satisfying all this level, then you can go for the implementation in the structural element, like a beam, slab, column, like that. Then on the other side, we can also go for non-structural element. Then the research should not stop in that level itself. It has to reach the field or the society point of view. Society should get benefit from the research. So we have to implement the developed concrete into the field of practice. So this is how we have to do for any developed new concrete. So in that angle, we targeted with MS20 of minimum. And we have done a lot of trial, and these are the some of the element tested for different trial mixes in different curing condition, because the full water curing is possible for on the site, and sometimes they used to go for intermediate curing, like covering the element with a gunny bag and then sprinkling the water over that, and sometimes people will not do anything, any curing at all. So in the curing, so these three types of curing we have taken, and we also as I said earlier about the durability point of view, see that a cross-sectional view of the concrete taken at 28 days and after 2 years, see that there is no degradation of the coconut shell. This left-hand side is shown the 28 days and right-hand side shows the after 2 years, and middle is shown the some of the conventional concrete comparison. Always normally we are going for the parallel track, comparing the results of a new concrete with the conventional concrete with the same sample. Then only it is possible to decide how our new concrete is behaving with reference to conventional concrete, and it's also predict the results, or that is compare the results. Conventional concrete is doing like this, our concrete is doing like this. Like that, we can easily compare. For that purpose, always you have to travel in both the track. One is taking conventional concrete, other one is taking our new concrete. In the way, we always do all the tests in parallel with the coconutional concrete and the conventional concrete. This is a flexural test, split tensile, impact test, pull-out test for bonding, and durability test like a water absorption, permeability, sorptivity, volume of permeable pore voids, RCPT. Then, since it is a wood-based material and timber-based material, people ask about the fire resistance. Then, we know there are four types of classification of structures are there normally. One is, as for NBC, One is, if the structure or element is resisting a fire without any problem for 4 hours, then it is called first type of building, first class building. If the element or structure is resisting 3 hours fire resistance without any problem, then it is called second class building. 2 hours resistance, third class building. 1 hour resistance, fourth class building. As far as this cognition is concerned, the minimum residual strength required as per ASTM 330 says that if at all anything fire is happening in your element, the residual strength of the concrete should be minimum of 17 Newton per mm square. That is the minimum required strength for saying the safer side of fire resistance. So in this case, cognitional concrete, 2 hours or 200 degrees centigrade, there will not be any problem. That means cognitional concrete can be classified as second class building. So these are the some of the example, the cognitional concrete placed in the oven for 100 degrees centigrade, 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, and 4 hour, 200 degrees centigrade, 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, 4 like that. Up to 400 degree, 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hours, and 4 hours, we are tested and we concluded that it's a second class type of building. Then we enter into the structural element. We have produced the element called first one beam. That is the easiest element compared to slab and column. So we can grow for beam element and the testing is also somewhat easy. So we casted a beam. Here I would like to inform the participant. Cognitional is a wood-based material. Only additional process you have to take care about its water absorption capacity. Because conventional concrete aggregate may be having maximum of 2% water absorption, that can be easily adjusted. But in case of coconut shell, it was water absorption capacity is nearly 20% to 25%. So if you do not take any precautions, then the original water cement ratio, what you have added in the concrete, that nearly 25% it will be absorbed by the weight of a coconut shell, the coconut shell will get absorbed. So to overcome this efficiency in the coconut shell, one day before you allow it in soaking underwater, so that whatever capacity it has, it will absorb the water. Then on the next day, of course, maximum duration is 6 hours. This way it was tested. Coconut shell is absorbing its maximum capacity at the end of 6 hours. Beyond this, there is no maximum, absorption of water. So 6 hours enough, but nothing wrong 24 hours one day before. So on the day of concreting, next day, you take out from the coconut shell, take out the coconut shell from the water and allow it for surface level dry condition. That is called a SSD condition, saturated surface dry condition. So we are allowing the saturation for whatever capability having in the coconut shell will get absorb the water. And now before putting it to the concrete, as per our mix proportion, we are allowing for the surface level. Otherwise, what will happen? Each and every shell, coconut shell, will have a surface film of water. If you do not allow for surface dry, then it will add more water in the concrete. That will be advantage for workability point of view, but it will not give the strength. So because our strength is the inversely proportional to water cement ratio. So to avoid that, in SSD condition, you have to use the coconut shell in the concrete. That is the only additional process when you are going for the production of coconut shell concrete. So that was the things they were done. They are used to one soaking in the water. The next day, the surface dried. Then they are batching it. And then they casted the beam. Again, quickly, I saw some of the clippings. This is the soaking condition. This is the surface dry condition. And this is how the coconut shells of concrete are casted. Finishing. And immediately after the finishing, they are covering with the gunny bags. Next day, after demolding, they are going for curing without any delay. And compacting cube also casted for testing the strength. Then after that, they are covered with the gunny bag like a side curing condition. In all the time before, till the testing of the beam, they made this curing in a wet condition. In a controlled manner, they followed the curing. Because we need to get the proper result from the research. Just like that, we cannot take it as granted that we have done the casting and we have done the peering like that. Every researcher should do in the all the since beginning of the batching of the material till it is completion of the test, every step should be in a controlled manner they have to. Otherwise, we cannot rely on that is confident over the results of our elements. So we have taken much care in each and every step. In all the beams, we have done the same method and we are tested for that. And intentionally, we have casted a beam, one beam with over-reinforced section, because normally we use recommend for only under-reinforced section beam, because steel has to should not fail before concrete fail. That is the concept of using under-reinforced section. That means because concrete is a brittle material, once it reaches the maximum value, immediately without giving any warning, it will fail. So if it is happened to the concrete, then there will not be any time for the people to escape from that area. So there may be a casualty more. For to avoid that only, we are normally using it, recommending for under-reinforced section. But when you go for over-reinforced section, steel should not fail, concrete should fail first. So intentionally, we made a over-reinforced beam section and we wanted to see that the coconut steel concrete is also doing that concept of over-reinforced section or not. See that this figure, the surface concrete, when the testing is done, the surface concrete is getting crushed. That means the behavior of coconut steel concrete is similar to the conventional concrete. That was the final conclusion from all the research and all the parameters. And another one is, the purpose of providing stirrups in the beam is to take care about the shear, because the support elements or support points are subjected to maximum shear. So to avoid that cracking 45 degree or shear crack, we are providing the stirrups. So intentionally, we also taken the beam element by providing without shear and with the shear. So without shear, we wanted to check whether the formation of the 45 degree or shear crack is forming in the element or not, making it a professional concrete. And see that in case of a without shear reinforcement, the support section, when the loads are increases, it is getting crushed and it is getting expanded. And see that one is the top one is a conventional concrete element and the bottom one is the coconutional concrete element. Almost the shear cracks are formed when you are not providing the shear reinforcement. Again, this also proves that the coconutional concrete is behaving similar to conventional concrete. Then, after flexure and shear, we also tested a torsional. When you go for torsional, again, it has to develop a diagonal tension crack. See that the left-hand side is a conventional concrete, right-hand side the coconutional concrete. See that in both the cases, the diagonal tension cracks are formed. That means, again, the coconut steel is behaving here similar to conventional concrete. Okay. So doing all this research, we have considered a complete structure in SRM University premises from bottom foundation to till the roof slab, completely making use of coconut steel concrete. I just quickly saw the photograph alone. This is site selected to construct your coconut steel structures. That is dimension, internal dimensions 8 by 8 feet. So four columns at four corners we have provided. This is the marking of the column and then excavation, and they are checking the leveling, the column pedal, and their foundation concrete laid. This is the only foundation or sand filling and foundation is normal with the normal concrete only. And after that pedal and then column placing it, the column footings, the people are doing the normal method of mixed this, mixed proportioning one. Only thing is the weight proportion, weight batching, we have done it as per the mixed design what we have proposed. Based on that, they've taken the matching of material, but the procedure, other procedure like a mixing and other thing, everything on the base on the Mason principle. Normally in what way they're using in the field, the same methodology they followed, and the photograph also shows that the same method, the Mason who involving the mixing of concrete and the mixer, and then adding some water and then doing the same methodology only. And then column is raised after plinth, then roof level, roof slab, and we wanted to study the behavior of the entire structure. So we placed the strain gauges and then deflection meter in the roof slab before casting, and we have monitored the entire structures for 2 days after 28 days setting up the concrete. So concreting, and see that this photo below the bottom, after removal of the formwork, all the wires are brought down and they are connected to the data logger. The loads are applied over the roof slab, making a cement back, because that is somewhat easy to know how much weight you have placed in your uniform manner, because every box is having the uniform weight of 50 kg. So they load out the cement back over the slab and they monitor the deflection stain develop continuously, and this is the final structure. And after done the test on these structures, we have left to the maintenance department and they are taken care of, and then they are using it for the maintenance purpose nowadays. And in addition to that, when I started this research in the year 2007, without studying the properties of coconut shell and properties of concrete itself, I called the mason in my native village called, my native is Kanjibram, and near the Kanjibram, there is a village called Ayambet. That is my native village. In that native village, I have my own farmhouse. In that, I called the mason and I gave the instruction that he how to cast the park bench, making use of a slab. But only thing is, instead of adding the conventional coarse aggregate, I'll give the equal amount of coconut shell. That is the only instruction I gave. Whatever procedure you are following it, whatever method you are following for casting the slab, that you do it and then cast the slab and then give to us. Like that, that's the only instruction I gave. And I gave that equal amount of coconut shell, which is after the SSD condition. I quickly saw the video. This is the SSD condition that is soaking in water. And this is the mason. In the normal way, they are placing some paper for below the slab. And just like that, they are placing the slab reinforcement. And this is the amount of coconut shell, amount of cement, and an amount of fine aggregate. This is they are taken on their own. And see that the mixing is done by the human. Woman must do. And she herself adding some amount of cement, what she wanted to add. There is no proportion on that. They decided themselves, okay, this much amount of cement is enough for this kind of amount of fine aggregate and coarse aggregate. And she herself mixed it up. And then the water also, after mixing, water also, whatever she wanted to add the water, the pot of water she added, and she prepared the mix. And she has given the prepared coconut concrete to the mason, and he has done this on his own way. Likewise, many slabs, yeah, they are casted. And finally, they constructed a park bench like this. And for your information, the supporting hollow block is also making use of coconut shell concrete. The same method was the conventional they are following it. And finally, this park bench, two numbers they are constructed, and these two members of park bench, they are loaded with some material, and still it is, of 13 years are gone, still it is working in a proper way without any problem. Then, as I said in the earlier, both non-structural and simultaneously, we are also concentrated on production of non-structural elements. I'll just show some of the product which we have produced making use of coconut shell. This is the hollow block and jolly works we have produced making use of coconut shell. This is a solid block. Then paver block. In all the method, we just follow the normal conventional layman method only. And we have compared the results of those conventional paver block and then the coconut shell paver block, making use of the standard recommendations. This is the manual cover making use of coconut shell. This is the mosaic tile. The first figure shows the conventional mosaic tile, and we have used that coconut shell. We asked the people to replace the stone chips in place of we just use the coconut shell. This is the mold and this is the brushing machine to produce the coconut mosaic tiles. They produce the mosaic tiles, and then whatever methodology they followed, they are just followed. And finally, we have used this mosaic tiles making the coconut shell concrete, and we have done it in the SRM for some area. And also we have concentrated on producing the pipe, non-pressure type, pressure pipe. And we have tested for the same methodology in the factory. We approached one factory of pipe production. There I gave the instruction again, just replace the same amount of coconut shell in case of coarse aggregate and do all the tests. And we have done it, and we have published in the SA journal also. Then the fencing post. This is the fencing post we have taken from the reference of standard code, and we have selected one size, and we have produced it, and we have tested for it, and we have done it. Then while crushing the coconut shell in the pressure developer, we have found that 3/4 of the coconut shell raw material is getting in the form of husk. Only 1/4 we are getting as aggregate. So what you have to do for this husk? Why don't you try with the concrete again? So like a rice husk. We have tried for replacing the fine aggregate, but we are not succeeded. We are not able to get more than 15. So we dropped that idea initial in the initial stage, and we have concentrated to use this coconut husk in the form of ferrous cement. So we have developed the ferrous cement concrete, making use of coconut husk, and we have made it a lot of material product, like a roof panel, particle board, and then a water tank like this. And then we have applied for patent, and we got the patent published on this also. As this is only a few seconds, one of the solid block produced with the coconut husk and the coconut shell, normally if you are dropping from 1 meter height, the block should not get failed. That is the indication, that is the requirement from the code point of view, even for the brick also. Now, this guy is my research scholar by the time. This guy is going to drop a block from his above head. That too, not on the normal level ground, not normal earth ground, it is on the laid concrete ground, concrete road. I just see that how the solid block, whether it is failed or not. And the second time, the same block, you will just throw it out and see that by the time also, whether they're breaking it or not. Just watch this. It's only a few seconds, so I'll play completely so that people can get confident over that. See that this is the concrete road in the SRM, one of the concrete road, and he is holding that solid block, and he is lifting over his above head, and he is going to drop it now. See that he just dropped it. See that nothing has happened to the block. Now you see that the same block, going to throw it to some distance on its capacity of harm. See that. Now he's going to throw it. See that he is thrown it, and see that nothing has happened, but it is rolling it. So that kind of speciality is there in case of your coconut shell. So this is so the lightweight concrete we have produced in a sustainable point of view, making use of coconut shell aggregate. Now, I just quickly go to the another type of concrete called a fiber reinforced concrete. Now, what is fiber reinforced concrete? So we know that concrete is having a proverb called strong in compression, weak in tension. So plain concrete has very low tensile strength, limited ductility, and little resistance to cracking. So these are all some unavoidable deficiencies in the normal concrete PCC. So when you are using some fibers into the concrete, the composite will have superior properties and performance. Many types of fibers are used in the production of fiber and concrete, like your polypropylene, nylon, asbestos, coir, glass, carbon, jute, and then steel, organic fiber like a cotton fiber, silk fiber, camel wood fibers, etc. But it has been recognized that the addition of small fiber, closely spaced fibers to concrete would act as a crack arrester and would improve the static and dynamic properties. But the basic requirement for your proper, that is fiber, we are expecting some properties from the fiber. The fiber should have high tensile strength, high modulus of plasticity, some adequate extensibility, good bonding between the interface of your material and the concrete, chemical stability, durability. You should have some energy absorption. It should resist the shock and dynamic loading and impact and fatigue. Then, if you see the properties of fiber reinforced concrete, it will have the ability to stop or delay the propagation of crack. That is the main properties of FRC. So it gets stretched more than the concrete under loading. It has an ability to resist corrosion also. So tensile strength will get enhanced, shear strength will get enhanced, compressive strength also will get enhanced because of adding your new fiber into the concrete. But what are the factors which affect your concrete, fiber reinforced concrete? It depends upon your type of fiber. It depends upon your fiber geometry. It depends upon your fiber content, how much you are using it. And it depends upon how much volume fraction you are using it. Then, when you say the type of fiber, again, the properties of fiber will affect the properties of your fiber and concrete. Then, the fiber content, that is nothing but a volume fraction. So how much volume are you using it? There should be a limitation for the volume of fraction. Depends upon your type of fiber. Beyond that, if you use some additional volume, then the problem is sometimes there may be a bundled effect. That means the orientation of the fiber may not be properly distributed. It will be oriented in some particular place in the form of balling effect. That is called balling effect in the form of bundled manner. So that should be avoided. Similarly, In case of orientation, orientation means for a normal poster concrete, we know where the tensile stresses will occur. So by knowing that exact location, we use to provide the steel reinforcement there. Similarly, in case of this kind of concrete also, we have to locate it, identify where the principal tensile stresses may develop. There you have to properly orient this fiber reinforced concrete. Otherwise, our purpose will not be solved. Generally, 1% to maximum 2 to 2.5% normally depends upon the type of fiber they use to go for adding the fiber into concrete. But when it is nothing done, when you go for adding more type of percentage of volume, that is they used to call high volume fiber reinforced concrete. Some people used to say the purpose of adding fiber reinforced concrete to enhance the tensile strength of the concrete. Then why you wanted to add in the compression zone also? For that, they used to identify the threshold limit for the compression zone and the threshold limit for the tension zone. So after identification of this zone, differentiation in the compression tension zone, they'll use the fiber reinforced concrete only in the tension zone. That type of concrete is called a partially fiber reinforced concrete. So likewise, many things are there in case of fiber reinforced concrete. Here, what I have done it, this is some of the example different fibers used in the concrete. So as I said, some of the basic properties of per se and factors affecting and the effect of fiber. See the graph shows that the stress versus strain graph. There are three curves are there in the graph. The first one is called a plain cement concrete curve. The second one is with low fiber. The third one is a high fiber reinforced concrete. We know that toughness is nothing but the area under the stress strain curve. So if you are able to calculate the area under the stress strain curve, that is the toughness of the material. So in that angle, look at the area under the PCC, look at the area under the FRC with low fiber, look at the area under the FRC with the high fiber. So when you go for adding more and more volume, there may be some advantage, provided if you are able to avoid the balling effect. So the toughness of the materials also increases. The see the right hand side figure, one of the fiber which is not able to split into two parts. Suppose if the fibers are not there, the concrete can be easily split into two parts. That is not happening in case even after failing also. So that is the specialty of the concrete. So likewise the application, again here also, you can use it for anywhere like a residential, commercial, industrial, highways, airport, wherever it is feasible, wherever you want to have the more resistance against the impact and abrasion, especially there you can go for this application of cement, that is a fiber reinforced concrete. Here, again coming to the sustainability, we have established the cognitional concrete, and why don't we use the fiber reinforced concrete, making the same the family from the same family of concrete fiber. So this work is done by my one of my research scholar called Dr. S. Anand. He already got that award, a PhD on that, the last March 6th. He has done the work on adding coconut fiber in the cognitional concrete, and he got awarded PhD on that. Now quickly see that again the similar kind of availability of coconut shell and coconut fiber at the industry. Of course, the coconut fiber is also used in many other applications. Even for the soil erosion also they are using it. So like a development of coconut shell crusher, he also developed a cutting machine for fiber, because we need to go for the optimization of the aspect ratio and volume factor. Aspect ratio is nothing but the ratio of length to diameter. So how much maximum aspect ratio and how much volume we may go for making use of coconut fiber in the coconut shell aggregate. So the whatever result I am showing, it is not applicable for other type of concrete. If you want to go for other type of concrete, there you have to, again, once again, you have to do the research, and then you have to find out what may be the optimum aspect ratio and what is the optimum volume fraction. So in this case, he has found that for conventional concrete, 83.3 is the aspect ratio, and for coconut 66.67, and then volume fraction is 3% in both conventional as well as in the coconut shell concrete. So this is the cutting machine he developed for cutting different length of the fiber, and this is how they are using it cutting. When you want the size of the fiber we want to do, normally the size of the coconut fiber is very fine, the diameter. So they have taken the SEM images to find out the diameter. Almost 0.6 millimeter is the diameter of the fiber they are taken for the calculation. So these are the different aspects. This is the diameter of the coconut fiber, 0.6 from the SEM images, and different length he has taken, 10 millimeter, 10 feet, like that, up to 60 mm. So depending upon this length as well as the diameter, the aspect ratio comes like that is 100, 330, 333, and the 50, 66.7, sorry, 33.33, 83.33, and 100. So for this different combination with a different percentage he has selected, I just saw simple quickly. So this is how he has selected. And as I said, it is a 83.33 and 66.67 is the for conventional and proportional 3% volume factor the maximum for the both workability as well as strength point of. And he has done the again beam also. See that the fibers are distributed in a uniform manner, uniformly distributed. So again, all the tests he has done it, and then he has also got publication, and then in SA International and got awarded. As part is over. Now I am coming to the self comment again. Comrade, again I'll running short of time. If I give time, I'll go for an elaborate manner. Otherwise, overall we will go through that.
You can take your time, sir. No problem.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
It's very interesting, sir. So
okay. So first, as I said earlier, self compacting concrete. So what is self compacting concrete and how it has to be developed? So self compacting concrete can be defined as a fresh concrete that flows under its own weight and does not require any external vibration for compaction. That is the specialty of the self compacting concrete. You need not go for any external compaction to compact it. So it can be used in the construction where it is very hard to use the vibrators for construction consolidation or compaction of the concrete, and also where the element are having very congested area of reinforcement. So it is a special concrete as the fillingability, singability, and segregation resistance characteristics in the fresh state of condition. So how this self-compacting concrete is developed? This concept of self-compacting concrete is developed by a scientist or research scholar called Okamura in the year 1986, but it was not until 1988 when the first prototype was developed by the another researcher called Ozawa in Japan. But many mixed design methods are developed for self-compacting concrete, but since the mixed design method for conventional concrete is not practicable for self-compacting concrete, of all the methods, the rational method, normal mixed design method proposed by Okamura and Ozawa seems to be the simplest and most popular method for developing a self-compacting concrete. There are some other methods called blocking volume ratio, particle packing theory, phase rheology theory, and compressive strength method. But out of all these methods, again, the rational design method is simple and very cheap. You can easily follow that. It says that you have to fix the coarse aggregate content at 50% of the solid volume and fine aggregate content of 40%. Then the water cement ratio and superplasticization, because without superplasticization, it is not possible for self-compacting concrete production. So that has to be determined by doing some trial mixes. So for that, there is a guideline called FNOT. We have many standards for different countries, but even then, FNOT is the best guideline for development of your self-compacting concrete. So there is an organization called in Europe called FNOT. They are also experts for specialized construction and concrete system. That is, FNOT is the European Federation dedicated to special construction chemicals and concrete system. So they gave the guidelines for self-compacting concrete specification, how to produce it and how to use it. Therefore, if you want to produce the self-compacting concrete, the procedure given in FNOR can be taken as the guideline to ensure the compliance of the self-compacting requirements. But what are the benefits of the self-compacting concrete? We can do faster construction. We can reduce the manpower at the site. We can easily place it. So it will give better smooth finish, surface finish. It also improve durability. Very thin section is also possible. Very, very thin section where we need not go for the compaction making use of some other methods. That thinner section is also possible making use of self-compacting concrete. And of course, because of use of vibration technique, there may be some noise. So that can be avoided here. That noise level can be reduced. Then, in general, what are the materials can be produced, used for the self-compacting? It is normal cement, normal aggregate, but maximum limit is 20 mm. 20 mm or 10 to 10 mm is normally preferable. When you go for a fine aggregate, nowadays due to scarcity of the river sand, M sand can also be used with uniform grade. If the fine aggregate size is, particle size is less than 0.125 millimeter, it is generally feasible to produce the cell compartment without any problem. Like a normal water, you can use it. Of course, without mineral admixtures and chemical admixtures, it is somewhat difficult. So you can use it some mineral admixtures and chemical admixtures. Mineral admixtures like a fly ash and GGBS, lycopium, stone powder, of course, fibers, some fibers also you can use it. And chemical admixture like a super processor, you can use it. Then, okay, you are doing some, you are using some material and you are able to, you are going to produce a cell compartment. What should be the requirement from the cell compartment concrete requirement? That means, after production of your concrete, whether you can able to say it is a cell compartment concrete or not. For that, there are some requirements. Like a filling ability, you should have some passing ability, you should have some segregation resistance. Segregation is somewhat important in case of cell compartment concrete, because if the segregations are happening in your concrete, then there is a lot of a problem like a formation of your voids, honeycomb, and that may lead to durability aspect. So to conduct to test your cell compartment concrete produced, to meeting out these three requirements, filling, passing, and segregation, many tests are there. Like for example, for filling ability test, slump flow test, T50 centimeter or T500 millimeter slump flow test, Artemid test, V-panel test. So these are the normal tests they are using for finding the filling ability of your self-parting concrete. Then for forcing ability, L-box test, J-ring test, U-box test, fill-box test. Then for to segregation resistance test, again V-panel test, in addition to the V-panel test, during the V-panel test also, one more parameter called T5 minutes. Making use of that, we can able to see that whether it's a segregation is happening or not. And then one more test is called a GTM screen stability test. So these are the many tests are there. So we have to fill the requirements to say your concrete is a cell compartment concrete. Your concrete should meet filling ability, passing ability, and segregation resistance. Right. So what are the advantages of this cell compartment concrete? If you are able to use the self-compacting concrete, permeability of the concrete is decreased. Self-compacting concrete construction will give faster. Problem associated with the vibration can be eliminated. Concrete can be easily placed. Can result in large cost saving. And durability and reliability of the concrete structure is high compared to normal concrete structures. Finally, the noise from the vibration can be reduced. And but there are some disadvantages. What are the disadvantages? There is no globally accepted test standard to undergo cell compartment concrete mix design. That is the only problem. That is the disadvantage. Then the initial cost is high compared to conventional concrete is somewhat high. Cell compartment concrete production is somewhat high initially, but the advantage is later stages many. Then while doing the mix proportion, design the mix, you have to be very, very careful going for the batching of materials. That should be done in a precise manner, and lab tests also should be conducted in a proper way. That is also another disadvantage. Just like that, you cannot take it an advantage or granted to produce the self-compacting concrete. So the selection of materials also more stringent. You have to be very careful for the selection of materials. Then, what are the application of it? Because the subject topic itself, application in the sustainable point of view. So construction can be, you can go for complicated reinforcement. Where the construction of structure with complicated reinforcement, it can be used for repair, restoration, or renewal construction. It is highly stable and durable for retaining wall construction. And then, of course, you can employ for raft and pile foundation also. So those places also, you can go for this application of self-compacting concrete. Now, coming to the presentation here, so far I have given only overview. Now, again, one of my research scholar from Nigeria, Mr. Adebekin Aziz Abikin. He is a full-time research scholar under my supervision. He has developed the concrete, coconutshell concrete, self-compacting coconutshell concrete. He also completed, and he, the last December, he got awarded PhD. Now he is Dr. Adebekin because of this, developing self-compacting coconutshell concrete. So again, the development, here the objective is developing a self-competing Congress with coconut shell as first aggregate. So he has taken many material, and as I said earlier, some normal cement and then some mineral admixtures, some chemical admixtures. So he has formed one flowchart for his study. That means he has done a lot of trial by changing the different proportions of different materials, and finally he has to satisfy the concrete produced with the coconut shell as a self-compacting concrete to meet the requirements of FNOC, like a filling ability, passing ability, and segregation resistance. So for him, for his study, he himself developed a flowchart, and he has followed it. And after many trials, he has done the he has arrived at the mixed proportion, and he has done all these tests, making use of this FNOC recommendation, and finally he achieved some mixed proportion, and he has tested. This is how the test slump flow and free funnel GTM, all the requirement. So that is because it's a research for the doctoral level. So he has done all the work. That he is the guy, is our Mr. Adi Bakin Aziz. Now he has become Dr. Adi Bakin. So finally he gave conclusion that it is possible to produce the coconut shell concrete self-comparting manner. So these are the result. This is how the batching he has made it, and he has done. I just see that. I just show that how this concrete is flowing and filling and without any segregation. That is important. See that this is the produced self-compacting coconut shell concrete. We can able to see how it is uniform, how it is homogeneously there. And see that the produced concrete, the mason is placing the concrete at one end of the beam. See that it is flowing on its own way without any external vibrations. Yes, the mason is not at all placing the concrete at different places. He is placing the concrete at only one place. And see that till the other end of the beam, it is flowing on its own way. You can also be able to see that there will not be any segregation from the aggregate or segregation from the cement form mortar. You might have watched that the mason has placed the concrete at one end of the beam, and it is filling and pausing to the other end without any problem, without any segregation. So now, again, based on the production, they have done all the research and then tested for the structural element also. Now, I'll just quickly touch up with the reactive powder concrete. This is another special type of concrete. So before that, I'll just give the overview. So reactive powder concrete is a ultra high strength concrete. Before we further discuss, see the high strength concrete. What is high strength concrete? What is ultra high strength concrete? So if you look at the IS 456-2000, they are given some group of concrete in table number 2. They are given that M10 to M20 ordinary concrete, M25 to M55 standard concrete, M60 to M80 high strength concrete. So those three categories are there in the IS 456-2000. Now, if you are able to produce the concrete minimum M150 and to the maximum possible up to 250, beyond 250 also well and good, then it is called ultra high strength concrete. So if you are able to produce the ultra high strength concrete, then it can be called as a reactive powder concrete. So the main concept adopted in this reactive powder concrete is they are using the elimination of post aggregate in that. They are not using the conventional co-aggregate, post aggregate. They are using only quartz sand and quartz powder for as a aggregate. So the main concept adopted in this reactive powder concrete is the elimination of use of conventional coarse aggregate, and hence they used quartz sand, which increases the compressive strength. So the concept of reactive powder was first developed by a research called Richard and Cherisik, and it was produced in the year 1990 in France. So compressive strength of reactive powder concrete normally ranges from M200 to M800. So reactive powder concrete not only has ultra high strength in the range, but also has high ductility because they are using some fibers also. So the principle followed in the development of reactive powder concrete is, first one is elimination of use of coarse agaric to enhance the homogeneity of the concrete. Then the use of phosgenic properties of silica film to optimize the granular mixture of the enhancement of compacted density. Then the use of super processor to reduce the water content ratio and improve the workability. Then during this production of reactive powder concrete, they are also used to go for applications of pressure before and during the setting of concrete. That is also another procedure, the development of reactive powder concrete, to improve the compaction. So once you apply the pressure, density can be increased, and because of density increases, it can be LC. And also after setting, they also go for some heat treatment to change the microstructure level of the concrete. Then they also had some small steel fiber to improve the ductility property. Now if we look at the properties of reactive powder, the reactive powder has high compressive strength, high flexural strength. So because of elimination of aggregate, high compactness achieved, application of heat treatment enhances the microstructural properties and homogeneity of concrete. So in turn, it reduces the water permeability, water absorption, high resistance to chloride and penetration, enhances the ductility property of the concrete due to the addition of steel fibers. Long life of the concrete can be assured. Now, the application of reactive powder concrete. Because of the reactive powder concrete, it can be applied where we need to go for lower structural weight, thin components, roof for stadium, and large span structure even in seismic region because of high ductility compared to conventional concrete. Now, yes, these are the some of the material used for reactive powder, quartz sand, quartz powder, silica film, steel fibers. And I already discussed about concept, principle, and property application. And see that these are some applied reactive powder. The first one is this is the first bridge used to making use of a reactive powder concrete as a pedestrian bridge in Sherbrooke, Quebec, Canada. So it was used during the early days of reactive powder concrete production. The another bridge is constructed using reactive powder concrete as Kongai Tibet Railway Bridge. Then the another structural lightweight rail transport constructed in the Shenzhen. So all these structures are encourage the research scholar and encourage the people who are doing the construction, constructing the bridge building in North America, Europe, Australia, and Asia. In Portugal, they constructed a seawall anchor making use of the reactive powder concrete. In Australia, there was a project called one of the projects they used a vehicular bridge. And of course, in France, after this bridge constructed in the earlier days, they have constructed a power plant building also in France. So, the advantages. Because of the advantages of high ductility, it plays with steel fibers, the ductility can be improved a lot. Now we are not using any, we are using only five ingredients. So there will be a void free and there will not be any no leakage can occur. And the reduction of sulfide because we are not using any conventional aggregate. So it has a great resistance against seismic force. These are some advantages. Now, but even then, there are some limitations for a reactive powder concrete. That means the replacing the aggregate materials in the production of reactive powder concrete are slightly costlier than the normal force because you are only quartz sand and quartz powder is the main raw material. And since we are going for the optimization principle, then there may be cost of production is maybe high. And then long-term properties studies so far, though there were many constructed, but a literature point out there won't be any long-term durability aspect properties are not available. So a lot of scope is there for research point of view in reactive powder concrete. And finally, as I said earlier for self-compounding concrete, here also there is no official portal provision for mixed design. That is also one of the limitations. So far what I have covered is the normal cognitive concrete, which is my work of my PhD. and another PhD after my guidance, after my PhD under my guidance, cell compound cognitive concrete, and then cognitive fiber reinforced concrete. And it is not clear that reactive powder concrete is not directly related to cognitive concrete, but anyway, it is a topic itself special concrete, so I have to cover one additional concrete, that's why that one. And then apart from this work, one of my research scholar called Prakash Chandar, he is doing that work for replacing the river sand by quarry dust in cognitive concrete, because nowadays the problem is river sand for every bar. So there you going for M sand. M sand is by the process of your dust. After processing from dust only, they are coming, that are producing M sand. So why don't you go for using direct dust itself? Because it's only research. So we can avoid the processing of M sand process. So in that angle, he has already done the work. He has submitted the thesis. He is waiting for the thesis evaluation report. The another one colleague is Ramasubramanian. He is doing that other part, like use of M sand in reverse sand, in place of reverse sand in cognitive concrete. And another research scholar from external candidate, Mrs. T.S. Lakshmi from GRT Engineering College. She has taken another form of technology called steel concrete, steel camp sandwich. In that, she is using cognitive concrete in place of conventional concrete. She is also published today morning. She got one publication from accepted publication from SA Index Journal, and soon she is going to submit the synopsis. And another research scholar called Prasad Kumar. He has taken that other using some different admixtures like fly ash, GGPS, micro silica in the cognitional concrete. And he also already submitted the thesis. He submitted the synopsis. He is writing the thesis now. And as I said, many people are doing many works, and we are also doing lot of non-social element like solid block, hollow block, fire block, etc. And finally, recently, another form of technology called precast construction, pre-engineering structures. In that also we have touched. One of my research scholar called Mr. Edwin, he has joined as a research scholar and doing this work, and he has taken this element, precast element connection with the cognitive concrete. So this is how my work is going on. Of course, I wanted to discuss about many types of social concrete, like hot weather concrete, cold weather concrete, then smart concrete, that is nothing but electric concrete. So because I can speak even for more than 2 hours for every type of special concrete. But giving this short period of 1.5 hour, I think giving some lot of information is possible, but somewhat in elaborate manner, my thought is it has to reach to the participant in a perfect way. That is why I took this only limited special concrete. If time permits, if some other opportunity arises, we may meet once again for this discussion in sustainability of other type of social concrete. I take this opportunity to thank the Ramco Cement, Anil Kumar sir, and then Suraj sir, Surya Kumar, for giving me the great opportunity to speak in front of all of you. I take this great honor on my head. Thank you, sir. And thus I am winding. If any questions are there, I am ready to discuss.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very interesting presentation. In fact, you had started with lightweight concrete. In fact, many professionals are not aware of it. You know, you have opened the horizons, you know, beyond aggregate. Why not use coconut shell in different types of concrete, lightweight concrete, fiber reinforced concrete, self-compacting concrete. It was a very interesting presentation, and I thank you for sparing your time. And I should also thank Mr. Surya Reddy for coordinating the entire program. And it was a grand success. And we would definitely would like to, you know, if it's okay with you, we would like to have many more presentations, on special concrete. Yeah. In fact, the kind of passion that you showed in the topic, you did not stop at research itself. The interesting part was that it was practically implemented, and it was very interesting to see that it has been used at SRM University as well as in your own house at your native. You know, that is very interesting, because
the real success of research is reaching the society in a perfect way, implemented. Okay. That is the real success of research. Any review. That was my intention. That was I used to tell my students also. Thank you, sir.
That is very interesting, sir, because many times most of us practitioners think that research means it's only in paper and in the thing, but you have shown that it can be used practically also. That's the interesting part of it. So I think we have lost contact with the speaker. So a very interesting topic, and I think he has covered sustainability from all perspectives, you know, whether in terms of decreasing weight, using coconut shell fibers for fiber reinforced concrete, and using it even with self-compacting concrete also was very interesting. So overall, we will find that the scope is not limited, you know, it's so vast. And as the speaker rightly pointed out, there is no standard mixed design procedures for many of the concrete mixes like self-compacting concrete and all that, but we have to do a lot of trials. So the success of the entire program is the number of experimental program that you can have, the number of demonstrations that we can have to ensure that the desirable properties of concrete is not sacrificed. A very interesting presentation on sustainability. Of course, from a cement perspective, we can always see that the blended cements, you know, whether the usage of fly ash and slag also contributes to the sustainability perspective. So when as a concrete technologist, let us also expand the horizons to the usage of aggregates, to usage of alternate materials in aggregates. Yes, sir. Thank you. No problem, sir. So I was just, you know, thanking you for the interesting presentation. So can we have some questions also, sir?
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir.
Yeah. The thing is that one of the questions that one of the participants was asking is that usage of coconut shell as replacement for fine aggregate, which you had mentioned, it is not possible also in your presentation.
Not coconut shell, coconut husk.
Okay. Coconut shell can be used as a replacement for fine aggregate also?
It may be right, because we have to, the problem is we have to reduce the size of coconut shell less than 4.755. So that is somewhat difficult as of now, but it is possible to crush it less than 4.75, then it can be used as a shell, as a fine aggregate. But what I have told is, while crushing the raw material, raw coconut shell in the coconut shell crusher developed in the SRM, we are getting husk as a separate crushing, while crushing it up. So we tried ourselves by using this as a fine aggregate in the concrete production. We could not able to achieve more than M50. We have to do, because my aim is, the problem is, when you want to use this coconut shell concrete for the field practice, it is not so difficult for people who are living in Chennai or who are living in Mumbai or Delhi. So my aim is, the research aim is, where the coconut shell is abundantly wasted, they are treating as a waste, those people can use this without wasting as a landfill. They can be used to come forward to use this as a aggregate in the concrete production. So that was the intention. But if you want to use it in Chennai or Mumbai or Bangalore, the transportation cost will become more. So you have to transport. So that is the intention. That is the idea. And I said, as coconut husk, the production of fine aggregate is somewhat difficult as of now. My aim is, as much as possible, you should not go for adding extra process, telling extra process. So using coconut shell in the concrete itself, people should accept easily. If I say that you have to use, along with the coconut shell, you have to use superplasticizer, you have to use microsilica, you have to use this or that, they will not come forward to use that material immediately. So as much as possible, I am avoiding the additional process. If at all not possible, if there is a must, when you want to go for only adding some mineral admixture and chemical admixture, then only we have to go for that. So in that case, it is possible to use it.
Another question is, what is the effect of seepage on exposed surface coconut shell concrete? Any effect on that?
We have done the permeability test, water absorption. As much as water absorption is concerned, it is somewhat beyond 5% is the maximum allowable limit for conventional concrete. But in case of coconut shell, it is having more than 5% to 10%. But even then, compared to all other lightweight concrete, making use of different materials, It is comparable. So again, as I said earlier, many research has to be done to implement in a structural point of view in a massive structures, or whether we need to go for leakage proof structures. Now, as of, it's feasible to go for application of the coconut shell for simple structures.
In fact, many of them have complimented your presentation. They have said that it was nice and informative session. Participants have enjoyed the presentation. And one more question is, what is the energy absorption value and flexural value in replacement of fibers?
Yes, sir. It is more than 30%. more than 30% compared to with and without fiber. So for example, compressive strength itself, when you are when you do not adding that coconut fiber in the conventional concrete, it gives only 30 megapascal. When you had this optimized percentage of 86.67 aspect ratio and 3% volume fraction, we got it for more than 43 megapascal. Similarly, in case of coconut shell concrete, before adding coconut fiber, it is only M25. After adding fiber, it is more than M30.
Another question is, what is the density of concrete using coconut shell compressive strength value comparing with normal concrete?
Yes, sir. We targeted with M20 and M25. In that, to produce the concrete, we need to add more than 500 kg per meter cube of concrete, that is a cement, for coconut shell concrete. Normally, for M25 grade of concrete, if you want using conventional aggregate, it will need only 300 kg to 350 kg, that is 6 bags to 7 bags. But in case of coconut shell concrete, need to add 10 bags of cement. You can ask the question now, you are adding more amount of cement now. But while using 7 bags of cement, we are getting the conventional concrete density is 2400 and 2500. Even when you are using 10 bags of cement here, we are getting only 1970 to 1950 to 1971, less than 2000 kg per meter. That means per meter cube of concrete, we can able to reduce 500 kg per meter cube. Obviously, when you are using the same strength of concrete with less density, the cross-sectional details required for dead load point of view and the moment point of view, the area of reinforcement also will get reduced. So ultimately, it has become cost effective, though we are using more amount of cement. The second one is the waste we are minimizing as a landfill. Environmental safety is we are looking at. Then overall, whatever material you're using for the production of lightweight concrete, it is cost effective. It is proved in many cases. In one of the American massive project, they saved 19% of total estimated cost by adopting lightweight concrete in place of conventional concrete. In one of the, one more quote I can show, I can tell, in Australia, there was a project. They decided to go for the particular project in a particular location. Location has been decided. That is the location. There is no other choice. For their project, they wanted to construct more than 50 stories in the particular location. But as per the existing soil condition, that is not possible to go for more than 35 stories in the particular area. But they wanted to have more than 50 stories in the particular location. So what they finally decided, they go for lightweight concrete use in place of conventional concrete. Finally, they produced the lightweight concrete. They constructed in the same place 52 stories in a cost-effective manner. So overall conclusion for lightweight concrete is, if you're able to produce lightweight concrete, it is cost-effective. It doesn't matter what material you're using it.
Okay, sir, you have also covered the cost-effectiveness part of it also in the answer. So that is very, very interesting. And one last question, sir, how about the bonding of shell aggregate in concrete? Is there any test?
Yes, sir, we have done it to pull-out test. I have shown the picture also. As IS 456 and BS standard says that for M25 grade of concrete is only, less than 2 Newton per mm square is the bond strength required, bond stress required. Even IS 456 also gives tau C and tau bond stress also. Some limitation, all the values are maximum of 3 Newton per mm square one. But from the test conducted on pull-out test on both conventional concrete and coconut shell concrete, it is more than 7 Newton per mm square in all the cases. We have done taking the two method of steel rod, like a MS rod as well as HIST bar. Mild steel, like Fe250 and Fe415. What we found that in case of your mild steel, when you do the pull-out test, after slip of your 0.025 mm, as per IS 2770 code book says about pull-out test, after that, the rod is coming pulling out when you are using mild steel. In case of HIST bar, the grip between the rod and the concrete is high. And by the time, we are able to see that the formation of vertical crack on the specimen used for the bonding test, and after that only it is getting split. So that splitting of bond specimen is not happening in case of mild steel bar. But even then, the bond stress, as per the requirement of our IS 456 and British standards, it is only less than 2 Newton per meter square, but we are getting more than that, 6 and above. So there will not be any problem. That is the reason why you are done for a pleural test and then chest test and torsional test are shown. You might have seen that if the people are observed proper correct kind of manner, there will not be any horizontal crack formation in any element. So if there is a bond problem in the element, then there may be a chance of formation of horizontal cracks while doing the test. That is not at all happening in any case of your element, even flexure, shear, torsion, even in case of shrinkage crack slab test, or even in case of a fully constructed structure also. So if any horizontal cracks are there in your element, then there is a problem of bond. It is not at all happen in our element. So there is no problem for bond stress.
One of the attendees have also places like Goa, I stay, I would like to use where coconut is in abundance.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. And other attendee has remarked, is there enough quantity of coconut shell available if you plan to construct multi-story building?
That's what I told, sir. Overall production is concerned, world level, India is playing a third place after Indonesia and Philippines. And if India level is considered, 90% of the total production is concentrated in South India, and Kerala plays a top one state. So the availability of coconut shell, where it is available as a waste, there you can use as an aggregate. That is the aim of the development of this established coconut shell concrete.
Sir, I think the discussion will keep on going because the kind of interest that you have generated is enormous. It's really nice that you have covered all the aspects. We had planned the discussion for 1 hour, it went on for 2 hours. So I think we should be needing one more session on this. It was really an interesting presentation by your side, and let me tell you,
summer occasion, we create events and invite me, and I am ready to.
Sure, sir, we would like to have.
If the lockdown is clear, even if you call in person also, I am ready to come over there and present.
So nice on your part, sir. And the subject that you have covered, the sustainability perspective, even from the climate, this thing also, the global warming and all, I think it's really a revolutionary aspect. And if it implemented properly, I think, the construction can be made much more greener in the true sense. Really, thank you so much, sir. And thank you for taking off your time from your busy schedule. And in fact, the examples that you gave of idli dosha has created that appetite in all of us that we are approaching lunchtime. And I do not know how many of the attendees would go and have idli dosha during lunchtime itself. So that was a really good example that you have taken.
So that a simple example, people can easily remember what is special and what is conventional.
Exactly, sir. In fact, the type of dosas that you mentioned, paneer dosa to 99 types of dosas, would have really created so much appetite. So thank you so much, sir.
Likewise, n number of special concrete are there, having the same ingredients of normal ingredient. This is some extra, that's all.
Correct. That is really nice, sir. So okay. Tomorrow, thank you so much. So tomorrow we will log in again at 11:30. There would be an interesting session by the Vice President of Prism Concrete, the RMC India, tomorrow at 11:30 by Mr. Merchant, who would be again speaking from West Bengal, I believe. So, in fact, over the webinars that we had organized, we had speakers from different places, sir. From West Bengal, Odisha, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. It is like a kind of integration that is happening,
That's what integration is seeing me sitting in the home itself.
Correct. Really very nice. Thank you so much. And let me thank my team also for having given this, organized this. Mr. Surya Reddy, Mr. Suraj Kumar, who is the host, and our IT team, Mr. Karthikeyan, who has been coordinating this event since the lockdown has happened. I thank all of them. And I thank you, sir, for having taken this time off. Thank you so much. Till we meet again. Thank you, sir.
Nandri, sir. Welcome.